Not long ago, it came out in the news, the United Emirates are making a peace treaty with Israel. And it's going to be an official ceremony, and many people are excited about it. But one good thing came out already from this peace treaty. The remnant of the Jewish community in Yemen is going to move to Abu Dhabi, to the United Emirates. In Yemen, there is now between 1,500 Jews left. And these Jewish people are suffering in Yemen because the Houthis, whatever the name is, they are like the terrorists who are driving them crazy in Yemen and want to chase them out of Yemen. The American government asked from the United Emirates to do them a favor and to resettle the people, the Jewish community from Yemen in Abu Dhabi. 40 of the 100 people, or 50, 60 people are in, 40 Jews already agreed to move to Abu Dhabi and are pressuring the rest of the Jewish community to agree to be relocated to the United Emirates. Now, the Yemenite community is the oldest Jewish community in exile, in the diaspora. It's probably 3,000 years old. It's an argument if in the time of King Solomon it was already Jews in Yemen, or a little later. But you're talking about a very, very, very old age-old community there. Very strict Jewish, very committed community to Judaism. They always wanted to go to Israel, make Aliyah. In the last few hundred years, quite a few times, Jews from Yemen made Aliyah to Israel. The most famous and most big one was in the 50s. Israeli government hired planes. The Alaska airline, that was the only airline that was ready to do the job. And they airlifted almost 50,000 Jews within a short time from Yemen to Israel. It was a huge operation. What is usual? Jews are not made from one. Every Jew has three opinions. Some Jews decided to stay in Yemen. They didn't want to leave. In the 1990s, they rescued 1,000 Jews from Yemen. Some came to Israel, some came to New York. In the 2000s, the beginning of the 2000s, they also rescued another group. By now, it was left between 1,500 Jews. Why the Jews don't want to go to America, to Israel? I think it's a much better life. The biggest humanitarian crisis today in the world is in Yemen. What they lost in Yemen, they said that the education, the culture of Israel in America doesn't fit them. It's not for them. What is exactly there that doesn't fit them that's in Israel or in America? 1,000 years ago, lived in Germany, a rabbi, his name was Rabbeinu Gershom. Every child who went to a Jewish day school will usually know the name Rabbeinu Gershom. Very famous. He's almost famous like Rashi. But the difference is Rashi made a commentary to the Bible and to the Talmud that every child learns. Rabbeinu Gershom wrote some commentaries, but it's not something that he's not known because of his commentaries. He's known because of two rules that he made in family law, two institutions that he instituted in the Jewish family that made them famous all over the world by every Jew who ever lived since 1,000 years ago. Now, by Jewish law, a person can marry more than one wife. It's not encouraged, but it's allowed. When we look in the biblical stories about somebody who was married to more than one wife, it's not a regular story. It was a crisis. It was a need. Abraham was married to Sarah for many years. She could not have children. She initiated he should marry Hagar. He should have a child. And he had Ishmael. Later, God made a miracle, and Sarah gave birth to Isaac. Jacob planned to marry only Rachel, poor Jacob. And then he was misled by his father-in-law, Laban. He ended up to marry Leah. And because Rachel could not have children, he married Leah and Rachel. Then he could not have children. Rachel could not have children. He married Bilhah and Zilpah. But it wasn't the plan. He wanted to live with Rachel. The same thing later in the Bible with Hannah and Penina, the mother of Prophet Samuel. Normally, the original plan was one husband, one man, one woman being married. How we know that? Already in the beginning of creation, when God created Adam and Eve, he created Adam and Eve. That's it. One man and one female. One male, one female. And he told them, therefore, a man should leave his mother and father and cleave to his wife and become one. That was the original plan. Also in the Talmud, we don't have any record of Talmudic rabbis who were married to more than one wife at the same time. Actually, the high priest, when he enters the Holy of Holies, he has to be married, but not married to more than one wife, only one wife. But it's allowed for extreme cases. From a biblical point of view, came a thousand years Rabbeinu Gershom, who was the chief rabbi of the Jewish people in Germany, and basically the highest authority of Judaism in Eastern Europe, in Western Europe, where then the Jews lived, France, Italy, all these places. And he made an institution, a rule, that nobody can marry more than one wife. And he used the biggest weapon that he had at that time to enforce the rule. It's called a cherem. A cherem means ostracizing you from the community. If somebody will do it, they will not count him to the minion. They will not do business with him. He will be ostracized. And he said he made a cherem that a person can marry only one wife. Why was so important to him? What was the reason for this rule not to marry more than one wife? There is a few explanations. One explanation is at that time, the Jewish people, they became businessmen, used to travel to other countries. And they used to stay a long time there, months. Then what happened is some guys started to marry other women in different countries. And what happened is a person had two families, one in this country, one in another country, before days of internet, before anybody was going on, then could end up to be that the child from one country where he has a family in Italy will meet one day a family in Germany, and a brother will marry a sister. They will not even know it's the same father. And more than that, what happened is if the man had another family in another country, he wasn't in a rush to come back to the original wife. And she had nothing to eat, and the family and the community had to support her. It was trouble. That's one reason. Second reason, some say that Rabbeinu Gershon himself was married to more than one wife. And he created huge animosity in the house to a point that one of them wanted to cause Rabbeinu Gershon's death. And on top of it, one of his sons converted to Christianity because of this rift in the house. And he saw firsthand, he experienced that was a wrong decision to do. And he wanted to make sure that nobody goes through the same hell that he suffered from. And there is a third reason. The Jewish people lived in a Catholic environment, in a Christian environment. In this environment, marriage altogether is considered a sin. Marrying more than one wife, unheard of. And he felt the Jewish community, they're going to live there for a long time. And he was right. The Jews lived in Germany for 1,000 years. He said, better for the Jewish community to respect the people who live around them and to marry more than one wife. In any case, whatever the reason was, all the Ashkenazi Jewish communities at that time came together and accept upon themselves the rule and were very strict about it. The Sephardic communities, they didn't accept the rule because they were not living. At that time, there was not, things were not known so fast. They lived their lives. But in reality, they lived by it. Most of the Sephardic communities married only one wife. There were even communities who used to have the custom that by the wedding, by the chuppah, they make the husband swear that he will not marry another woman. But there is one exception to the rule, the Yemenite Jewish community. They were a very old Jewish community, very jealous to their own traditions and customs that they had all the way from basically from the time of the first temple. And they said, nobody's going to teach us a new Torah, make new rules. And they continued to marry, some of them, obviously, not all of them. A few of them married more than one wife. Even in the 50s, when they came to Israel, they came with more than one wife. And Israel grandfathered them and allowed them to come to stay married. Even that the law in Israel is that you're not allowed to marry more than one wife. The law in the United States is again that you're not allowed to marry more than, you're allowed to marry only one wife. Maybe this was the one that was, that's the culture that are not used to, maybe other things. But this is something very unique to the Yemenite community. Rabbeinu Gershom made another rule also connected to the family. And this has to do with the parsha of this week. In the parsha of this week, we read about the laws of divorce. If a man marries a woman and he wants to divorce her, he should write a bill of divorce and then they can be divorced. They will be legally divorced. That's a get. Came Rabbeinu Gershon and he made an unbelievable rule that is more advanced than any other feminist Western world idea about feminism. And he did it already 1,000 years ago. You see, the Jewish law, we learned that the Torah, when Eliezer went to look for a shidduch for Isaac, Eliezer was Abraham's servant. He went to Haran to look for a girl for Isaac, for a shidduch. And he met Rebecca, and he wanted to take her to, he asked her to take her to go back to Israel to marry Isaac. She was a cousin of Isaac, from the family, a first cousin. After a whole discussion, in the end of the discussion, Laban, her brother, and her mother said, we will call the girl, the bride, the future bride, and we'll ask her, whatever she says, it will go. Then Rashi says, from here we learn, that you can marry a woman only if she agrees to get married. You cannot force anybody. Like many other cultures, force girls to get married. In Jewish law, from the beginning, from Isaac, the son of Abraham, 4,000 years ago, right straight in the Bible, you have to ask the girl if she wants to get married. That's already old 4,000 years ago. Rabbeinu Gershom came and he said something unbelievable. He said, not only you have to ask her if she wants to get married, she has to agree to get divorced. You cannot divorce her against her will. You see, in the modern society, we serve papers. We serve the papers. A couple wants to get divorced, they get divorced. You don't ask your spouse if he wants to get divorced. It's a nice word, you serve papers. It's a nice word for a tragedy, really. Like in America, in modern society, we have nice concept, nice words for anything. Full service, self-service, serve them food, serve them papers, you serve everything. But you don't need the consent of the other partner. In Jewish law, since Rabbeinu Gershom, you need to get the agreement of the woman that she wants to receive the get. If not, you cannot get divorced. No rabbi will make a divorce for you. No Beit Din, no Jewish court, nothing. You're stuck. And it's practiced every day in the Jewish world. But Rabbeinu Gershom, because of these two rules, became famous in every Jewish home. Became a household name. Every child knows about him. But especially he has a special title. It's called Rabbeinu Gershom Meor Agola, the illuminator of the exiles. So to speak, he brought light to the Jewish exiles, to the diaspora. This is a title that only he got. There is Rosh HaGola, the exiler, the aid of the exile before, but the illuminator of the exiles, only Rabbeinu Gershom got this title. that once the Rebbe asked in a talk, why Rabbeinu Gershon, more than any rabbi before and any rabbi after, got this special title, the illuminator of exiles? What kind of flight he brought, what kind of excitement he brought to exile? They made nice rules. Many rabbis before them made special rules, many rabbis after them. Great rabbis who wrote amazing commentaries to the Bible, like Rashi and Maimonides. And what's unique about them? The Rebbe said something amazing. You know, we are now in the month of Elul. Elul is the acronym for four letters. We mentioned it last week. Ani ledodi vedodi li. I am to my beloved, and my beloved is to me. What does this mean? I am to my lover. Who is my lover? God and the Jewish people are married, a husband and a wife. God is the lover, and the Jewish people are the beloved ones. We are the wife, and he's the husband. The Jewish people as a whole. Now, there is a rule, we spoke about that last week too, in Judaism, that whatever God tells the Jewish people to do, himself is doing. If the Jewish people have a certain tradition that they obey to, God himself obeys to this tradition. That when Rabbeinu Gershon came and said, a man cannot divorce a woman against her will. You know what he said, really? He said that God cannot divorce the Jewish people against the will. You cannot say, okay, I'm tired of you guys. You worship idols, you do this. I had enough of you. No matter what, just as we cannot divorce a woman against your will, God is tied and is obligated to the same rules. And no Jew deep down wants to be divorced from God, that God cannot divorce him. And then God has to obey to the second rule. Just like Rabbeinu Gershon said, a man cannot marry a second wife on top of his first wife. God cannot go out and say, you know, you were the chosen people 3,300 years ago at Mount Sinai, 3,331. I will choose another nation. One chosen people, yeah, number two, we'll find somebody maybe be more willing to do, will not argue with me about every little thing, not question me, not argue, not say, oh, I'm not comfortable with this sign in the Bible, it doesn't sit well with me, this issue. Wait, another nation too. Comes Rabbeinu Gershon and said, you cannot marry a second wife. You cannot have another nation that will to choose them in addition to the Jewish people. Basically, God is stuck with us, with the Jewish people. And that's what Rabbeinu Gershon accomplished. He sealed the deal. He made a rule that God cannot get out of it. And that gives security to the Jewish people. Just like in a marriage, there is a certain level of security. There is a security in the marriage between God and the Jewish people that we are not going to, never going to be abandoned. And we will not going to abandon God. That's why he deserved the special title, the light of the exiles. For this, he deserved this title. Thank you.